morning. Welcome to our service of morning prayer. Welcome to everybody at home. Welcome to those who are here this morning who've come out in I think, the first of our chilly Sundays this year. But it's really good to see everybody. If you don't know who I am, my name is Cliff. I'm the curate here. One more year, at least. So it's good to see you. We are following our green books. If you haven't got one, you can always contact us. And we will send one out to you. So we're going to begin our service on page 2, but before that we're just going to have a moment of quiet as we start our service. Come Holy Spirit, as we start this time of worship, enter into our hearts and minds and bring us close to God during this service. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're at the top of page 2 in your green books. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and also with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. There is that prayer at the bottom of page 2. I would like us all to say that together this morning. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. We come to a time of confession, our opportunity to say sorry to God. So let's just take a moment. Let's think back over the last 7 days to those mistakes that we've made. As Katie says last week in our sermon, through ignorance, through weakness, or through our own deliberate fault. But let's just take a moment and lift those moments up to God. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. We say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So may the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. We're going to sing our first hymn for this morning. It's hymn number 1375, right nearly at the back of your mission praise books. We have no music today, but we have the lovely Bill who is going to lead us in this. So 1375. Who, O Lord, could save themselves? And if you're able to, please stand.
You alone can rescue, you alone can save.
about, I love the music and I love the guitars and they really help, but sometimes it's nice to sing a cappella, you know, and Bill's got a wonderful voice, so thank you very much. We're going to continue our service. We're on page 4 of your green books. Blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now through the deep waters of death you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ your light ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. We are going to read a psalm together. The psalm today is Psalm 124, and it can be found on page 623 in your pew Bibles. I'll just give a moment for those of you who are at home to find that for yourselves. Psalm 124. So we're going to say this together. If the Lord had not been our side, let Israel say. If the Lord had not been on our side when people attacked us, they would have swallowed us alive. When their anger flared against us, the flood would have engulfed us. The torrent would have swept over us. The raging waters would have swept us away. Praise be to the Lord, who has not let us be torn by their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the fowler's snare. The snare has been broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. I'm going to invite Janet to come up and bring us our Bible readings, and then Lee is going to come and bring us God's Word.
Good morning, everybody, and everybody at home. Our first reading is Esther, chapter 7, verses 1 to 6, and then chapter 9, verses 20 to 22. This can be found to start with on page 505 in your Bibles. So the king and Haman went to Queen Esther's banquet, and as they were drinking wine on the second day, the king again asked Queen Esther, "What is your petition? It will be given you. What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it will be granted." Then the queen answered, "If I have found favour with you, your majesty, and if it pleases you, grant me my life. This is my petition. And spare my people. This is my request. For I and my people have been sold to be destroyed, killed and annihilated. If we had been sold as male and female slaves, I would have kept quiet, because no such distress would justify disturbing the king." King Xerxes asked Queen Esther, "Who is he? Where is he, the man who has dared to do such a thing?" Esther said, "An adversary and an enemy, this vile Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and queen. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs attending the king, said, "A pole reaching to a height of 50 cubits stands by Haman's house. He had it set up for Mordecai, who spoke up to help the king." We now go to, because the king said, "Be in pain and mourning." We now go to chapter 9, starting at verse 20. This is on page 507. Mordecai recorded these events, and he sent letters to all the Jews throughout the provinces of King Xerxes, near and far, to have them celebrate annually the 14th and 15th days of the month of Adar, at the time when the Jews got relief from their enemies, and as the month when their sorrow was turned into joy and their mourning into a day of celebration. He wrote them to observe the days as the days of feasting and joy, and giving presents of food to one another and gifts to the poor. Our next reading is Mark chapter 9, beginning to read at verse 38, and this can be found on page 1013 in your Bible. Teacher, said John, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop, because he was not one of us. Do not stop him, Jesus said, for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Truly I tell you, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name, because you belong to the Messiah, will certainly not lose their reward. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them if a large millstone were hung around their neck and they were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands to go into hell where the fire never goes out. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter the life crippled than to have two feet to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worms that eat them do not die, and the fire is not quenched. Everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Have salt among yourselves and be at peace with each other. Our final reading is James chapter 5, verses 13 to 20. This can be found on page 1216. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns as a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Still our hearts as we listen to what God has to say to us this morning. Father, be with us now as we look at your character and welcome you into our hearts. May we always pray in faith. Amen.
Amen.
So today we've reached the end of our James series. It's been such a great book. I've so enjoyed going through this particular book. And it's the end of our Walk the Talk series. If you haven't watched all the talks, do feel free to look back on them, on the recordings. I'm just going to move that down because I realise the mic's right in my face on the camera. So I'm just going to move that down so people don't see a big microphone in my face. But yeah, do feel free to look back at those recordings, because they've been great. I've so enjoyed the book of James. I remember when I first heard the phrase, there is power in prayer. It was during my very first Alpha course many moons ago, and it was actually on the away day. I remember visiting this lovely church where we had this away day, and we sat in our groups, and our group leader said, he was talking about the topic of prayer, and he mentioned this power of prayer, and it really struck me. I just wondered what he was actually talking about. I thought my prayer life at the time was okay. I always felt a connection with God. But this word power in this context was a new concept to me. It made me curious to know what power he was speaking about. I knew that it wasn't a power that meant every prayer that I prayed would be answered in the way that I wanted it to be, if only. But it just made me want to know more and more about it. I learned over time that the power of prayer was in relation to my faith in believing in the importance and the significance of those prayers and how I prayed. So as James comes towards the end of his letter, he kind of bookends it with three topics, and they're all centered around praying. He gives instructions for what to do when we're cheerful, if we're suffering or sick, and then what to do for someone who has wandered away, how to be able to bless them and guide them back. So if I may, I'm going to break down those topics. Now, I couldn't imagine only ever speaking to my dear mum when she was alive, during the times when I needed something from her, or when I was in trouble. I would often share the good times with her. We'd laugh together, and some real many laughs sometimes, and we'd encourage each other and share those happy times. And these are the times that God cherishes too. Worshipping him, rejoicing, sharing our gladness and happiness with him. So why at times don't we go to our Heavenly Father to do this? Our default tends to involve spreading joy with our friends and family first, or by posting something on our social media. And I actually found myself doing this yesterday, and I know some of you have seen this. Now it may seem small and insignificant, but I finally dug up a small crop of carrots. I planted those carrot seeds a few months back, and I've been tending them, talking to them, dare I say, and watching them grow. And yesterday, we had some carrots! Now, what did I do? I ran inside to tell my husband, holding this little carrot in my hand, with gladness and with pride. I can't say that his response was the same, but he did say, well done, it's a carrot. And then I took a picture of the said carrot and I put it on my social media. But what I should have done first was thank God. He was the one that sent the rain to water the crop. He put the sun in the sky to make it grow, and he produced the soil. He should have been my first go-to to pray in my joy. Sharing happiness with others is fine. It's a good thing. But James reminds us to go to God and rejoice with him, in him, with songs of praise. Give him the glory. He talks about praying for those who are sick. I'll be honest with you, when I'm suffering or feeling unwell, of course I pray for myself. But it's on another level when I ask others to pray for me. It's where I release a bit of my suffering. And I feel the power of prayer. There's that phrase again, power of prayer. Praying for someone who is suffering from a heart which is deep rooted in faith, it can move mountains. I've asked my brothers and sisters in Christ for prayers of healing on many different occasions. For my pain to be taken away or to be more manageable. But let me share this with you. Although it hasn't yet, I'm still in a tremendous amount of pain, and there are days where I really struggle, both physically and mentally. But when I hear those prayers of faith for my healing from those around me in my church family, the hope that it brings me, this is healing in itself, I find. And that's the power of prayer. I feel anointed because of those prayers of faith. I feel covered. I really do. I've also witnessed healing when we have prayed for someone. In particular, I think of one rainy afternoon when we spontaneously came back into the church after going home from a morning service and sat together to pray for our Bill, who was very unwell at the time. I remember praying for him with my whole being. We all did, with everything that we had. We felt the Spirit moving over us. We were in the presence of God. We were at the foot of his throne. I look at Bill now and I praise God for hearing those prayers of faith. James also speaks about confessing our sins to each other. Being a family for me means accepting, means taking on everything, warts and all, accepting each other in whatever we're going through, having others back when the going gets tough. No judgments here. When we're in the body of Christ, healing is possible. When one of us strays from the path of righteousness, we call them back. Not just with our words. We walk that talk. Showing others how to depend on the Lord, not on their own standings. Not going off to do, say, think the things that are not aligned with God's heart. Helping them to find healing. Healing isn't just about physical healing. It's about our spiritual healing too. Every Sunday we say the confession words together as a church family. We do this as individuals, but also we're doing it as a body. We want our hearts to be clean as we come before God, as we come together as that one body. It's a healing that we are invited to experience and feel, to be renewed, changed, receive God's amazing grace. When we pray for our brothers and sisters, we're communicating with the only one who knows our struggles and our failings, and the only one who has the power to transform someone into being more like him. Who wouldn't want that for one another? When we confess our sins to each other, James isn't saying that we should spill everything we've ever done in our lives, every wrong we've ever done. But if we see someone struggling, we can come alongside them. Pray for them in faith. Be part of God's healing process for them. Be with the person who has grown weary, who feels spiritual dryness. And I've experienced this on a few occasions. And when someone has come alongside me in those times, my goodness, I feel the healing. It reminds me of the story of the lost sheep. Jesus never gives up on searching for the lost. And if we're to be like him, then neither should we. I love how James references Elijah towards the end of this passage. It amuses me that he mentions him as being human, like us. Of course, Elijah was human, but he was also a great prophet of the Lord, with a great example of using faithful prayer. In a nutshell, on this particular occasion, he prayed for the weather conditions. Now, there have been a couple of days this past week where I thought of praying for the rain to stop. I tend to call it rain o'clock because it always pours down when I need to go outside for something. But Elijah prayed specifically, in this case for the weather, but not for his own gain. There was a reason for this type of prayer. He prayed with discipline and diligence. He was aware of what he was praying for and he kept on doing so. He prayed effectively. He knew deep within that God would hear him and respond in his way. And Elijah prayed righteously. He didn't allow sin to cloud his conversation with God. He came to him with a clean heart. As I said at the start, James has always been one of my absolute favourite books of the Bible. It's straightforward. Even I can understand it. He gives clear instructions for us how to live, how to be, how God intended us to live and be. So let's make the choice to live according to his will. Let's choose to submit to God, to serve others, not just in his name, but because we really want to, from deep down in our heart, because it's important for us to care for others and love others and to come alongside those who are struggling. Let's confess our sins in penitence and in faith to each other as well as to our Heavenly Father, and ask others to pray for us and to pray for them. Pray with our whole being in true faith. Remind others that our Lord is present in our struggles and times of being tempted, as well as our times of joy. Let's not just tell other people about his character, his heart. Let's show them who he truly is. Carry out his love for one another. And let's choose to always walk the talk. Amen.
Thank you, Lee, for that. It's a good reminder that all of us as Christians, we should be praying to our Father and knowing that he does answer our prayers, but not necessarily in the way that we want them. We're going to reflect on that as we're going to sing our next hymn. It's number 1008 in your Mission Praise Books. The Lord's my shepherd. Listen to these words. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff are the comfort I need to know. Prayer brings us comfort. Comfort because we know our Father hears our prayers. And we trust that he answers them in his own time and in his own way. So if you're able to, please stand and remain standing at the end of the hymn.
Trust in you.
standing and we say our creed, which is on page 7 of your green books. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you'd like to sit down, we're going to turn back to page 6, and we're going to say the Benedictus together. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight, all the days of our life. And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of all their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Having spoken about prayer this morning, we're going to enter into a time of prayer ourselves. We're going to start by saying the collect, which can be found on the front page of your notice sheets. God, our Judge and Saviour, teach us to be open to your truth and to trust in your love, that we may live each day with confidence in the salvation which is given through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father God, we give you thanks for all the good things in our lives. The things that perhaps we take for granted, the things we don't realise are so special in our lives. We thank you for our families, our friends, for the love and support they give to us. We thank you for our homes, the shelters that we have in the storms. We thank you for the clean water and the food that we eat. We're reminded of the generous donation of our harvest and pray that those gifts will be used to help those who do not have what we have. And we thank you, Lord, that you are there every single day of our lives, that we can come to you when we're happy, when we're sad, when we're in despair, when we are in need. We thank you that your Holy Spirit equips us to live our lives. And we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who died upon the cross, so that we can be forgiven for our sins, for those mistakes that we make. Even if we don't mean to, we know that they hurt people. So thank you. Thank you for being that continuous presence in our lives. Amen. We pray for all those who are sick, for those who are homeless, for those who are in financial troubles, for those who have emotional worries. Each one of us knows someone who needs your help at this time. So in a moment of quiet, let us lift those people to God now. Loving Lord, you know those that we have named today, and so many more who have not been named. You know their struggles, you know their needs, you know the help that they require. If they're in pain, remove that pain from them. If they are recovering, aid that recovery. If they are worried and frightened, take those fears from their minds and their shoulders. If they are struggling financially, grant them wisdom to know where they can seek help. If they are homeless, grant them your protection and a place of safety. They are starving, send them food and clean water. These things may seem impossible to us, Lord, but not impossible to you. May your Holy Spirit reach across this world of ours and be with those people who need your help at this time. We pray for those who do not know you yet, those lost sheep. We know, Lord, that you celebrate every time somebody comes back into your family, into your body. So, Lord, we think of all those little seeds that have been sown through people's lives. Holy Spirit, flourish them in their lives. Grow them in their faith. Bring them back to the Lord and enable us to play our part as witnesses to you. Give us the words that we need to help those people. And Lord, we pray for our world. We pray for our missionaries, Andrew and Lisa, who are here with us this morning. We thank you for all that they do and pray that your strength continues to equip them for their tasks, for their journeys. And we pray for our world. When we turn on our news and we see the troubles in the Middle East, troubles that are escalating, troubles that are getting worse, we are shocked and you are shocked by the number of people who are being killed day by day. So Lord, do a mighty work in that area. We pray for Israel. We pray for Gaza. We pray for Lebanon. We pray for Russia. We pray for Ukraine. We pray for Africa. Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for peace in our world. We pray for diplomacy instead of violence. those countries and show them a better path. And we pray for all these prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to join in saying the Lord's Prayer together, and as usual, in whatever version or language you are comfortable with. So gathering our prayers and praises into one, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So, are you doing the notices? I am, okay. Well, good morning. Welcome to the notice time. You should have your notice sheets. If you are at home, you can receive this electronically. You just need to email us and give us your permission to use your email address, and then we can send you an electronic version of the notice sheet. So things are continuing through the week. Our usual house groups are all taking part. This afternoon we have another rehearsal for our show, Let My People Go, which is going to be happening at the end of November, beginning of December. So even if you're not practicing or rehearsing, you are more than welcome to come along and watch those shows. It will be fantastic. So I'm really looking forward to it. House groups this week, as normal. Tomorrow is PCC in church. So if you're not on the PCC, just remember that meeting in your prayers. It's really important that we cover our PCC meetings in prayer. We have our usual youth activities taking place, and everything is the same for the week. The pastoral course on Saturday continues. We are doing safeguarding, so that's a really important message for anybody. So if you are interested, even if you haven't done the rest of the course, then please come along and join us. You did ask about the Wi-Fi. Bill, do you want to explain, or shall I? Oh, Bill's coming down.
Would say is keep the Wi-Fi in your prayers. So having missed a telephone call, given that all communications have been to my personal mobile from both Openreach and BT this week, almost daily, the engineer decided to call the church phone rather than my mobile. Having said that, I immediately got a text. I heard the phone in the distance, but sadly missed it. I got a text which said the engineer's outside. I was outside opening the church car park within a minute, and the engineer said, oh, I'm on to my next job because you didn't respond. And hopefully somebody will be back later. I then got so that was at 3 o'clock. At 4:15, I got another text to say the engineer's outside, he's connecting, you're beginning to do the work, connecting a service. And on both of these occasions, it allows you to reply to the text by saying, please let us know if there's any access arrangements or anything the engineer might find helpful. In both cases, I sent text to say, the car park is open, the doors are open, the gates are locked, access is available. And at which point I get a thank you very much, we will pass this on to engineer. So the second one, after 4:15, I went outside, even though everything was open, the cleaner was here as well, so there was lights were on, plenty of people in the building, but the engineer was nowhere to be seen, and I stayed here basically until 6 o'clock and nothing happened. So for our missed appointment, we've been charged £130, even though technically it's not a missed appointment because we were here. But so please pray for me, because that means that's a telephone call that I now need to arrange tomorrow to try and rebook the appointment and to argue our case that we were here and it was available and access. So it's a little stumbling block at this point. It's the final hurdle to get us. It's that final hurdle. You know, think of it, we've been climbing this way, this way, this way. We're nearly at the top, and then we're going to be zooming down our roller coaster, and everything will be going along. So it's the final, we're at the final peak. But we're nearly there, so do keep that in your prayers, please. Yeah, it'd be lovely to actually have some Wi-Fi in here and to be able to do the things that a lot of these things have been enabled. So if you don't know, both the sound system, the screen, and the lights have apps which can enable them to be changed. So we can actually change the settings in here without somebody having to either go to the back, go to the front, go to the side. It can all be done on an app, on a tablet, or on a phone. So as these features are enabled, it would be great if we could actually use them and actually use them to the fullest.
So do keep that in your prayers.
We're going to sing our final hymn, and if you're able, please stand as we sing My Jesus, My Savior, Shout to the Lord, 1003, 1003 in our hymnals, My Jesus, My Savior.
Service. If you're here in church, it's time to grab a cup of tea. If you're at home, it's time to put the kettle on. But thank you for joining us. We pray that you have a good week ahead. So let's finish with the blessing. The Lord bless us and preserve us from all evil and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.